Well, good Wednesday morning, everyone. Thank you for tuning in, and I know that you're going to be glad you did. Let me remind you that at our monthly food distribution for free is today at 9 a.m., 9 to 10:30 a.m. at the United Methodist Church on Moulton, right next to Coffee Bean. All you have to do is drive in. They fill your trunk with some food. You don't have to get out. So I hope you take advantage of that. If you could use some encouragement in your life as just an act of love toward you or one of your neighbors, for that matter. Well, this week we're talking about our health, our physical health. And we talked yesterday about how Jesus healed when he walked here on earth, how he healed many and what our responsibility in that is and so on. But I wanted you to know and be fully convinced that God still heals. It may not be every person. It is not every person. But he does heal. And I've seen many, but I haven't had many that are recorded and told, the story told so well as the one you're about to see, of a miracle that happened to a friend of mine. He became a friend of mine. I actually worked, his name is Greg Outlaw. We actually showed this 3 years ago on this show. So I'm dipping back to show you this video. I can absolutely verify that it is true. It's not just because I say it, it's because it's been written up in various magazines and other stories, and the doctors that are involved have verified that everything that Greg says is absolutely true. So I want, just so that we're totally convinced that God still heals. By the way, I've seen things like this. But with Greg's part, and he went on, he's one of my heroes of the faith, because Greg took what happened to him and went on to found a ministry that's been such a blessing to millions of people called allaboutgod.com. And you ought to avail yourself of that ministry also. At another time, I'll tell you, it's miraculous how that started. But I want you to hear Greg's story in his own words. And then let's just praise God for it. And we'll discuss it more tomorrow. Watch Greg and be blessed.
And I went home and I flushed every single drug I had down the commode. I think I stuffed it up twice. It was a lot of drugs to flush. I read the Bible 3 times straight through from cover to cover during this year and a half period. And at this time, I'm in such incredible pain from the chronic pancreatitis as it escalates and got worse and worse. After a while, I was forced to quit eating. I was being fed intravenously every night as I slept. I was on 300 milligrams of morphine. And through that period of time, God started cleaning up my life. I mean, even though I had quit drinking, I still wanted alcohol. But God took it away. I can't explain it, but all of a sudden, I couldn't even stand to see it or be around it. And then, you know, I got this laptop. Back in 1999, this was a $10,000 laptop. I had a gigabyte of pornography on this laptop. And I can't explain that either, but all of a sudden, I just felt like I gotta delete all of this stuff. And I did. I sat there and I deleted every single image on it. This was my portal to rebellion. It was my secret life that only I knew about. It was also the way I made my drug deals and my drug connections. I'd send out emails and code, and the other guy would get it and they would unencrypt it. I think it was my mechanism for escape. Because I could open that up, jump in that world, and in that world, I was completely in control of everything. It all bowed down to me. I could make what I wanted when I wanted. I could score what I wanted when I wanted to score it. And now it's used for God. It's now not all about me. Now it's all about God in the laptop. So as I go through this year and a half period, and I'm seeking God, and I'm praying, and I'm reading the Bible, I'm a dead man. I'm praying this whole prayer because I absolutely, without a doubt, I know I'm dying. And I left that company, and I felt like I couldn't take any money from it. 6 years worth of work in that company. I didn't take a cent. But I knew I had to make that decision that day. And then I went to bed, and I woke up the next morning, and I didn't have any pain. And to put that in its proper perspective, this was my life for a year and a half. I would wake up from a drug-induced sleep. I would reach on my nightstand and I'd grab a tablet of morphine and I would take that. I also had liquid morphine that I would take, fill up the dropper and drop it on my tongue to break through so that the other pill just could work. And I would wait for the pain to subside enough that I could actually physically get out of bed. This morning it was different. I didn't have any pain. I still took all of the medication and did my routine. And that day passed, and another day I woke up. The next day, no pain. The next day, no pain. The next day, no pain. Then I'm starting believing. I'm like, Jesus Christ did something to me. What is going on? This is so weird. I don't have any pain. And I start believing, and I'm like going, I don't even need this medication anymore. And so I get off the morphine. I got off 300 milligrams of morphine in 2.5 weeks. I mean, the pain management physician, I had a pain management physician. All he did was prescribe terminally ill patients medication to get them through until they were dead. And so I drove up to Fountain Valley to see him, and I waited in the waiting room, and he came in the door finally, and he looks at me and he goes, "You really look good, Greg. I thought that you would just like be sweating like crazy and shaking, you know, typical withdrawal symptoms." And I said, "Well, I feel great, Doc." He goes, "Well, tell me what's going on with you." And I said, "Well, Doc, this is going to kind of sound kind of weird." And he looks at me like, "Okay, now you've really gone off the deep end." He's like, started backing away. It's like, "Dude, this might be contagious. I need to get back." He goes, "Well, it's not that, Greg. It's not a miracle. It's some kind of anomaly, some kind of mind over matter game that you're playing." And I just looked at him and I said, "Look, Doc, you know me. You've been treating me a year and a half. You got 2 file drawers on my condition. You know that chronic pancreatitis at my stage, when it's pronounced terminal, is irreversible, that it's not transplantable, that after a while you can't eat any longer, and that it requires massive doses of pain medication just to get by each day. So how do you explain that I don't have any pain anymore, that I quit taking your medication, and that I'm eating again? How do you explain that, Doc?" And he just looks at me kind of like a deer in the headlights, and he goes, "I guess you're right. It must be a miracle." The process to forgive myself was really difficult, because it's one thing to ask for forgiveness from God and from others, and that's hard. But to forgive myself, it's constantly reading the Bible, where it says, "My sins are as far as the east to the west," and that my sins are cast into the bottom of the sea, that they are forgotten by God. And I can't beat myself up on it, because if I'm constantly beating myself up on it, that's like nailing Jesus back to the cross. I don't run my life out of guilt. I do it totally out of love, out of gratefulness and thankfulness that I have been forgiven. Reconciliation is a tough road to hoe when you've gone through so much wreckage of the past. But all things are possible with God.